ओके, अस्सलाम वालेकुम, वेलकम टू द 14th लेक्चर ऑफ डेटा माइनिंग। सो टुडे वी विल रैप अप आवर डिस्कशन ऑन फ्रीक्वेंट पैटर्न माइनिंग एंड देन आफ्टर दैट वी विल बी स्टार्टिंग विद क्लस्टर एनालिसिस। सो क्लस्टरिंग इज अनदर मेजर टास्क इन डेटा माइनिंग एंड दिस module of the course would also be reasonably large, I think two weeks, and we'll be covering a number of algorithms for cluster analysis or for clustering. So this is actually the end of the seventh week. We have kind of reached the mid of the course, and as such, I think many of you must have also started with midterm preparation. So our midterm is on March 13, which is the following Saturday. So in any case, we will be continuing with our content till Monday. So whatever is covered till Monday would be included in the mid-exam, which is the following Saturday. So before I get started, are there any questions? No questions. Okay, it looks like I've closed my OneNote. Let me open my OneNote. All right, so I did not hear any questions, so let me get started. So in the last lecture, we were talking about constraint-based item set mining. We talked about, in more detail, rule-based constraints or constraints that are expressed in the form of rules. And those rules are usually equalities or inequalities or conditions on inclusion and exclusion. And we characterized those rules into various categories. We said that rules could be anti, monotone, they could be monotone, they could be succinct, and then they could be convertible, and the rest basically. Okay. And for each of those, we gave some examples and we talked about some ways in which those rules can be used to optimize the search of patterns that satisfy those rules. So, anti-monotone constraint is a constraint similar to, for example, the support constraint that we saw in frequent item set mining. And it can be applied in the a priori framework in the context that it can be used for pruning from one level to the next. Monotone constraints are kind of the reverse of that. They cannot be used for pruning, but we can avoid checking those constraints once that constraint has been found to be satisfied from one level to the next. So let's say at L3, we found that a particular pattern satisfied a monotone constraint. We do not need to check that pattern against that constraint in C4, L4, and further on. Okay, so that was monotone. Succinct constraints do not have any impact on the algorithm. usually succinct constraints can be found to be succinct constraints can be checked directly on the patterns. So most common succinct constraints are min, max, and so on. And then we talked about convertible constraints. So there are some constraints that may not be monotone or anti-monotone, but they can be converted to one of those two. And usually that conversion is based on the order in which we write the items in an item set. So the usual examples here are averages of item sets based on the values for each item in that item set. So if you change the order and you define a specific order, let's say descending price value or descending value of items in the item set, then you can force that rule to become anti-monotone or monotone. Okay? And as I said, in general, if you're using a priori type of algorithm, anti-monotone is preferred because you can use it for pruning and it makes your algorithm faster. Okay? And then there are some constraints that do not fall in any of these categories, which of course are called others. And they are not really pushable. So one of the terms that we use was pushable. So pushable means that the algorithm or the rule or the constraint can be pushed into the algorithm for item set mining. So it's not applied after we have found all the item set. It is part of the algorithm. It's pushed into the algorithm. So these, we would like algorithms, we would like constraints that are pushable. I think I mentioned this earlier on as well. We would like interestingness measures as well that are pushable, meaning that they are part of the algorithm and they can be used to optimize the performance of the algorithm. Okay. So in general, so some constraints can be converted either to monotone or monotone. So those are called strongly convertible. So they can be converted to monotone depending on one order, or they can be converted to anti-monotone based on another order. And again, average is an example for that. Okay. So those are called strongly convertible. Okay. Finally, what happens if you have multiple constraints? So let's say you are given a task to find item sets that are frequent. Okay. Frequent means that support should be greater than some minimum support threshold. So that's a constraint. Plus, let's say you want to ensure that, let's say this is market basket analysis. You want to ensure that the sum constraint of all the item sets, prices of all the item sets is, let's say, greater than some minimum threshold, let's say whatever, theta, okay? So now we have two constraints. So can we use both of them together in an algorithm? So in general, you can use them together if they are of the same type and they do not require conflicting orderings. Okay. So support, of course, is anti-monotone. Okay. Sum greater than equal to some value. What is that? Is it monotone or anti-monotone? Sum greater than. So if something, a pattern satisfies this condition, all its super pattern would also satisfy. Okay. So this is actually monotone. Okay. So here, of course, the types of the two are different, but if they are different, of course, they can still be used because anti-monotone is going to be used in the context of pruning. Monotone would be used in the way that we don't check as we move from one level to the next. So they can be used together. ठीक है. सिमिलरली लेट से वो ऊपर मेरे पास सम उल्टा होता, लेट से सपोर्ट का है, दूसरा सम लेस देन सम वैल्यू थीटा, सो देन बोथ एंड देम आर एंटी मोनोटोन. ठीक है. सो इन दिस केस बोथ ऑफ देम आर एंटी मोनोटोन इरिस्पेक्टिव ऑफ द ऑर्डर. ठीक है, ऑर्डर कोई चेंज नहीं कर रहे हैं, आपको सपोर्ट के लिए भी ऑर्डर चेंज करने की जरूरत नहीं है, एंटी मोनोटोन सम सपोर्ट के लिए भी जरूरत नहीं है. ठीक है, सो अगेन दे कैन बी अप्लाइड टूगेदर फॉर एक सेकेंड. ठीक है, सो दे कैन बी अप्लाइड टूगेदर फॉर प्रूनिंग. सो फॉर ईच पैटर्न यू चेक बोथ कंडीशंस एंड इफ दैट पैटर्न इज प्रून बिकॉज ऑफ एनी ऑफ दोज कंडीशंस यू डू नॉट कैरी इट फॉरवर्ड. ठीक है, सो सपोर्ट की वजह से प्रून हो रहा है तो फिर भी इट वुड नॉट मूव फॉरवर्ड, सम लेस देन की वजह से प्रून हो रहा है तो यू डू नॉट मूव इट फॉरवर्ड. ठीक है, सो अगेन नाउ बोथ कैन बी यूज टुगेदर. बट लेट्स से एक सपोर्ट है मेरे पास और दूसरा मेरे पास एवरेज है जो मैंने सो मूव फॉरवर्ड बेसिकली द ए प्रायोरी एल्गोरिथम. सो इफ यू प्रून एनी pattern, that pattern is not used in generating the next candidate for the next level. ठीक है, so let's say you have support which is anti-monotone and average let's say less than some value theta. And let's say we have, so by the way, average less than some theta. So if you have a descending ordering of items, price-wise ordering of items in the item set, this would become anti-monotone. Because jaise hi wo violate karega, matlab average badh gaya theta se, to aage hum usse small prices ke items hi dal rahe hain, to still violate. But the issue now is that this is giving you a different ordering as opposed to let's say support ki ordering hai. Theek hai, yeah, okay, in this case actually you can still use this because one is support which does not require any ordering. Aap ye keh sakte hain ki aap ordering aapne price descending ordering hi use kar liye. So basically use price descending ordering of items. So then if you do that, then both can be applied together. Okay, just like in the previous case. Okay, so now let's say if you have two constraints for which the orderings conflict. अब इसमें ऑफ कोर्स देयर नॉट टू मेनी एग्जांपल्स फॉर एवरेज. लेट्स से एक एवरेज आपने प्राइस पे डिफाइन किया हुआ है, वो ग्रेटर देन समथिंग है ए लेट्स से, और दूसरा लेट्स से एवरेज आपने डिफाइन किया हुआ है लेट्स से आई डोंट नो वेट मैं कर देता हूँ, बट लेट्स से देयर माइट बी सम एग्जांपल इन विच यू वांट टू मिनिमाइज द वेट, लेट्स से पैकेजिंग सर्विस आपकी, तो लेट्स से वो वाला उल्टा मैं कर देता हूँ, बी कर देता हूँ. ठीक है, अब दोनों की ऑर्डरिंग डिफरेंट हो सकती है, प्राइस हैज नो रिलेशन विद वेट फॉर एनी पर्टिकुलर आइटम. ठीक है, सो व्हेन यू हैव कंफ्लिक्टिंग ऑर्डरिंग देन यू कैन नॉट यूज बोथ टूगेदर. ठीक है, सो इन दैट केस यू यूज वन ऑर्डरिंग एंड अप्लाई that constraint, and once you have found all the patterns, then apply the other constraint later on. Okay. So that you cannot use, or you cannot push both constraints together into the algorithm. A constraint push hogi, dusri nahi hogi. ठीक है. एंड ऑफकोर्स सक्सेंट कंस्ट्रेंट जो है वो पुशेबल नहीं होती. सक्सेंट कंस्ट्रेंट एल्गोरिथम को कोई इम्पैक्ट नहीं करती. दे कैन बी चेक्ड आफ्टर द एल्गोरिथम हैज रन और बिफोर द एल्गोरिथम हैज रन. ठीक है, वो एक उसका कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता. ठीक है. सो वन फाइनल कमेंट. सो लेट्स से व्हेन यू हैव मल्टीपल कंस्ट्रेंट्स whatever they may be, जैसे ऊपर मैंने options कुछ बताई हैं, anti monotone, monotone, convertible, non convertible and so on, conflicting order or not. But whenever you have multiple constraints, you can also use the idea of projected databases. ठीक है. So let's say a simple example लेते हैं. Let's say a constraint support की थी, support should be greater than let's say a. और दूसरी constraint let's say sum should be less than let's say b. ठीक है, both anti monotone है. ठीक है. So let's say मैं a की apply कर रहा हूँ algorithm के अंदर. So algorithm के अंदर मैं a apply करूँगा तो मेरे पास let's say कोई भी आएगा, l k आएगा for support greater than a. अब we actually because since these are all the item set that satisfy this condition, ab ye jo condition ka aap projected database le le aur usko fir aap us pe dusra condition bhi test kar le. Projected database se kya hoga ki chhota aapke paas database aa jayega. Theek hai, and then you can check for the other as well. So do you get this point? So let's say mere paas support ki wajah se do item a b और लेट्स से बी सी फ्रीक्वेंट आए सपोर्ट की वजह से. अब नाउ आई फाइंड द प्रोजेक्टेड डी बी फॉर ए बी एंड बी सी. और इसमें मैं देखूंगा कि डज माय सेकंड कंडीशन आल्सो सेटिस्फाइड. एंड देन इफ एंड वी आई ओनली रिटेन दोज आइटम सेट दैट सेटिस्फाई द सेकंड कंडीशन एज वेल ऑन दिस प्रोजेक्टेड डेटाबेस. बिकॉज ऑब्वियसली प्रोजेक्टेड डेटाबेस में वही ट्रांजेक्शन हैं जो सपोर्ट को सेटिस्फाई कर रहे हैं. ठीक है. सो यू कैन कंबाइन इट विद द आइडिया ऑफ द प्रोजेक्टेड डेटाबेस फॉर मल्टीपल कंस्ट्रेंट्स. सो आई थिंक दैट्स प्रीटी मच इट. So this slide has a table which gives you a number of constraints, rule constraints, and their categories. So you can refer to this table to verify which a particular constraint is. Also mentions whether a constraint is convertible or not. ठीक है. So strongly convertible means that you can convert it either way. ठीक है. देन वी हैव वेरियस एग्जाम्पल्स हियर. ठीक है. ठीक है. तो वेरियस कंडीशंस आर गिवन हियर. So that basically, I think, bring us to the end of this chapter and the discussion on. So, bring us to the end of item set mining. So, convertible, we discussed convertible last time. So basically, a constraint C is convertible to anti monotone or monotone or both after changing the order of items in item sets. So the example, usual typical example is price. So price of items, let's say. ठीक है? So if you order the price of items, if you order the items in descending, let's say, price. So let's say I have, let me take some example. Let's say 3 items ले लेते हैं. So grocery का item लेते हैं. Let's say, so for example, meat, ठीक है, milk, and bread. So this is price descending order. ठीक है. So whenever you create an item set, let's say remember जब हमने frequent item set mining शुरू में पढ़ा था, let's say a priori पढ़ा था, हमने a b c d कहा था, हमने कहा था ये lexicographic order. But if you order the items according to price descending order, then some constraints become monotone or anti-monotone. For example, average a price of an item set being greater than some value A. ठीक है. So let's say कोई order आपने price के basis पे order नहीं किया हुआ, इस ये वाली constraint you cannot guarantee it to be monotone or anti-monotone. But let's say आपने इसको descending order में हमेशा item sets लिखे और इसी तरह ही grow होंगे, let's say. So what happens? So if this rule is satisfied, for example, meaning that the average of any item set X is greater than A, so और उस next level पे जब उस item set में कोई नया item डलेगा, वो नया item हमेशा कम price का होगा, because descending order आप चल रहे हैं, ठीक है ना? जब कम price का होगा, तो इसका मतलब है कि उसका average average by the way कम हो सकता है, ठीक है ना? So in that sense, it is we cannot guarantee it to be, it will remain to be monotone. Come, it might violate the constraint. But let's say मैं इसको उल्टे order में करता हूँ. Let's say मैं bread, milk और meat के order में करता हूँ. Then whenever this constraint is violated, I think I'm mixing things up. Except. So right, I'm saying greater than A. सही है ना? ठीक है. So greater than A means violation का मतलब ये कि average कम है A से. ठीक है. So average कम है तो average हमेशा A से कम कब रहेगी? जब आप items उसमें add कर रहे हैं that are of lower value. ठीक है. तो इसका मतलब जो ऊपर मैंने लिखा था वो सही लिखा था. So basically आपने descending order में किया meat, bread, meat, milk and bread. तो उसके बाद जब भी कोई नया आइटम आएगा वो ब्रेड से भी सस्ता होगा, तो एवरेज हमेशा कम ही रहेगी, तो इट विल स्टिल वायलेट. सो इट बिकम्स एंटी मोनोटोन, स्ट्रिक्टली एंटी मोनोटोन. ठीक है. सो जस्ट बाय चेंजिंग द ऑर्डर इन विच यू प्लेस आइटम्स इन एन आइटम सेट एंड हाउ यू ग्रो आइटम सेट्स इन ए प्रायोरी, यू कैन मेक ए कंस्ट्रेंट एंटी मोनोटोन. सो सच टाइप्स ऑफ कंस्ट्रेंट्स आर कॉल्ड कन्वर्टेबल. सो एवरेज इज कन्वर्टेबल. So okay, so are there any other questions? So are there any other questions? So we now move on to cluster analysis. This is actually, I think, chapter 9, not 10, in your new text, your textbook on BiData by Han and Camber. But for this clustering, I think I will also recommend and strongly recommend that you also read the relevant chapter from the Introduction to Data Mining book. especially the evaluation part we will cover from that chapter. Okay. So you will have to use both books side by side for this particular chapter. Previous chapter ke liye bhi kar sakte the, but I did not strongly recommend that just to save your time. But iske liye I think it is better that you follow both books together so that you get a better idea of cluster analysis. So what exactly is clustering and what is cluster analysis? So basically a cluster is a collection of data objects. Objects could be anything, entities, people, objects, things that you want to analyze. And a cluster contains objects that are highly similar within a cluster and objects that do not lie in one cluster or they lie between clusters, they are dissimilar. So this is the general, you can say, layman definition of cluster. And a clustering basically is a process by which you can take some data, which is a set of objects, and put them into clusters. Meaning that you have multiple clusters. One cluster would have a group of objects that are similar. Another cluster would have a group of objects that are similar, but between the two clusters, the objects are dissimilar. Okay? So clustering is a key task, as I mentioned, in data mining, and it is distinguished from data segmentation. So generally, data segmentation is a simple way of partitioning your data. Remember, in clustering, you're also in a way partitioning your data. Objects jo aapke paas the, multiple clusters mein group ho jayenge. Data segmentation is also partitioning, but usually data segmentation is partitioning based on the value of one attribute only. So for example, so we are talking about now clustering. Okay. So data segmentation is partitioning the data, but it's based on a single attribute. For example, like we have the student database and you partition data based on gender. So this is actually data segmentation and not clustering. ठीक है, so what exactly is then clustering? Another way of looking at this is data segmentation is, you can say, as we discussed earlier, I think in the first lecture, it's kind of a deductive process. You can write an SQL query explicitly defining ke I need objects of males separately and females separately. Students, you divide the students by male and female, and you know upfront what would be contained in the group, one group, and what would be contained in the other group. In one group you have males, the other group you have females. So in other words, this is deductive. So this is another difference between data segmentation and clustering. So clustering in general is inductive. You don't know, you are trying to learn the groupings from the data. You don't specify the grouping upfront. Okay, you let the data tell us what the grouping is, and as such, so clustering typically involve multiple attributes. Okay, not just one attribute. So let's say if you want to group students based on all their attributes, so their attributes could include gender, of course. But they may other things as well. So age can be there. Grades could be there. Their height could be included. Their, let's say, even address could be included. Their GPA can be included, and so on. So if you are grouping students based on all the attributes that describe those objects, in this case students, then that is clustering. ठीक है? So clustering is not data segmentation. So data segmentation is segmenting or partitioning data based on one attribute. It's purely deductive. You know upfront what you will get. Clustering, you don't know upfront what you will get. You are letting the algorithm find those groups for you. And once you have gotten the group, then you go back and analyze what is in each group. Okay? And as such, it is inductive. And also, as you know, we talked about data mining is whatever you get at the end of the day is going, it should be non-trivial. So data segmentation mein jo segmentations ho rahi hain, wo trivial hain. Yahan, they are non-trivial. So maybe you might find a group of students that are highly related, let's say cluster one hai, but then you go back and look at all the objects in that cluster and figure out why they are related, and they will be related based on all the attributes, not just one attribute. ठीक है? So maybe quickly slides pe jaate hain and then let's go back. So clustering is one of the most popular algorithm or task in data mining, and it has application in almost all domains, from business to social sciences to humanities to the actual sciences. Okay, you will find applications everywhere. And also clustering as a concept is easier to explain to layman as well. So you can talk to, let's say, a humanities person and tell him that, okay, I've done clustering and found that these set of people or this set of objects, whatever you're analyzing, are similar. So that's something that people relate to very easily. On the other hand, associations that we studied earlier or even classification, they are much harder to understand or explain to others. And also clustering, as we had discussed earlier, can be used for pre-processing also. So data reduction can be done through clustering, but it's also a end goal in many data mining tasks. You want to kind of summarize the data. You want to understand the key characteristics of the data by clustering the data. ठीक है? So clustering can also be used for outlier detection. So, and that might be the end goal of your task. So maybe aapki fraud detection ki koi task hai, to usme clustering se aap dekh sakte hain ki kaun se objects are in clusters that are very small and far away from other clusters. So those usually would be outliers. Okay? So various applications, various domains are possible using clustering. So these are some of the applications from different domains. Okay, so you can read them up. So document clustering, the web search engines that you use, oftentimes they do employ clustering at the back end to group similar documents or web pages. So that is document clustering. So you can have GIS based clustering, so trying to group related use on the land. And also in the business community, clustering is widely used for customer segmentation. They call it segmentation, but it's not based usually on one attribute. So trying to find your customer base or characterize your customer base. So maybe you are a retail store like, let's say, Carrefour, and you want to characterize the people who buy at your store. So you do clustering. You might find 5-10 clusters, and each cluster would have their own distinct characteristic. One cluster would be people who buy very high-end objects and they come very rarely to the store. Other are those who buy who come very frequently and they buy, let's say, grocery stuff. Others who come frequently and buy electronic stuff. But this would be determined after you have done the clustering. The characteristic would be determined after the you have done the clustering. So what are the steps in doing cluster analysis? The slides provide a high-level view. So obviously, we are clustering objects. Objects are, as we said, entities or observations or examples. These are some of the names that we have used interchangeably. So you need to describe those objects. And the typical way of describing objects is through attribute values or some features and their appropriate values. Okay, so you have to define appropriate features for your task. Okay. So you need to choose features that are relevant for your end goal. So obviously, if you want to cluster and try, and one of the goals that you intend to use that clustering for is to identify customers with different buying behaviors, then obviously you would need to include price as a key feature in your clustering. And if you don't include price, obviously you won't be able to find any groupings based on price. Okay. The second main thing is a measure of proximity or similarity or dissimilarity. So this is essential. So you need to have a way of quantifying the similarity between two objects based on the features, of course, that you have defined or selected. Okay. So this is some usually called proximity measures, similarity measures, or dissimilarity measures. So this is something that we're going to start with today. So next thing is the clustering criterion. So what is the basis of your clustering? Meaning that humne layman terms mein pehle define kar diya, the basis kya hai? Within a cluster, object similar ho. Between clusters, object dissimilar ho. And let's say if you plot them on scale in a hyperspace, so dissimilar object will be far away, similar object will be close together. Theek hai na? So ye to humne layman terms mein bataya ki ye criteria. So you need to quantify or codify this layman concept into some mathematical formulation, mostly an optimization formulation. So that is called the criterion. Okay? So we need to talk about a criterion as well. So some cost function, some objective function, or set of rules. Then next is algorithm. So you need to have an algorithm that goes through your data and gives you those clusters according to the criterion using the similarity measure. So this is the algorithm. Okay. And of course, there is a lot of algorithms available. Of course, some of them are more popular than others, but we will kind of do a survey in this course. And then finally, you need to be able to determine the quality of your clusters. So that is evaluation or validation of your clustering. Okay. So essentially, these are the main, you can say, concepts as well as the steps involved in clustering. Okay. So what exactly is a good clustering? So of course, in layman terms, we have already talked about this in a number of times. So high inter-class similarity. Remember, we have now said that we have defined some similarity function or proximity function. So you can also say that cluster is cohesive. Objects are close together within clusters. And low inter-class similarity or dispersed across clusters. ठीक है ना, एंड ऑब्वियसली द क्वालिटी वुड डिपेंड ऑन द एल्गोरिथम एज वेल एज अ सिमिलैरिटी मेजर. सो विच देन मीन्स दैट eventual quality of a clustering is external to this process. So as we have mentioned so many times before, so these criterions that we use, these algorithms that we use, these are helping us to find what we really want. But the eventual judge of what we really want are human beings, and they usually cannot quantify their demands very nicely in some measure or in some algorithm. ठीक है, सो इवेंचुअली वी विल हैव टू एवेल्युएट इट इन सम अदर फैशन, एक्सट्रिंसिक फैशन. सो क्लस्टरिंग एवेल्युएशन एज सच इज इम्पॉर्टेंट एंड वी विल एंड डिफरेंट फ्रॉम लेट्स से क्लासिफिकेशन. सो वी विल डिस्कस दैट इन दिस कोर्स एज वेल. So there are various metrics. I think we'll talk about this later on for measuring the quality of a clustering. Okay, so now let's move on to. So are there any questions so far? So we talked about the proximity function, you can say, or measure. ठीक है, and as I said before, these are often sometimes used interchangeably with similarity or dissimilarity measures. ठीक है, and if you recall, we did mention names like similarity or dissimilarity or distance while we were talking about association rules. ठीक है ना, so वहां भी वही आइडिया था, दो पैटर्न होते थे, लेफ्ट हैंड साइड पे था, राइट हैंड साइड पे था, उनकी अपनी सिमिलैरिटी निकालनी थी. यहाँ आपके पास दो ऑब्जेक्ट्स हैं, ठीक है, उनकी आपने सिमिलैरिटी निकालनी है. सो द यूजुअल रिप्रेजेंटेशन दैट वी हैव इज वी हैव as we have mentioned before, a vector x, ठीक है, so vector x is basically, let's say, so this is a vector, so x i 1, ठीक है, x i 2, x i m, ठीक है, so this is the representation for the ith object, and each of these x i are the values for the respective features. ठीक है, so in other words, we have m features describing our objects. Capital M is the number of features, and for each feature we have a value for each of the object or each of the observation. Okay, so since so usually to represent it as a vector, I'll bold it. So I've bolded it here. Maybe later on, sometimes I will not bold it, but it will be understood from the context. Okay, so this is one object. So you might have another object XJ. ठीक है, सो वी हैव टू ऑब्जेक्ट्स एंड बोथ ऑफ देम हैव ए रिप्रेजेंटेशन. ठीक है, एक्स आई है और एक्स जे है. सो आवर गोल नाउ इज टू फाइंड द सिमिलैरिटी और डिसिमिलैरिटी. लेट्स से आई यूज डिसिमिलैरिटी डी और डिस्टेंस बिटवीन एक्स आई एंड एक्स जे. So I'm bolding it here again to ensure that these are objects. ठीक है, so we need to quantify this number. So this is the distance function, the dissimilarity function, and in general this is a proximity function. ठीक है, So this is what we need to define. So now let's look at some very common dissimilarity functions quickly. Okay. So let's say we have numeric attributes only. Okay. So numeric attributes only means that all the M attributes are numeric. Okay. All attributes are numeric. Objects are described by numeric attributes only. Okay. Or all the features are numeric. So इस केस में आपको पता ही है काफी कॉमन मेजर्स हैं. Can someone remember, tell me one measure that can quantify the distance between two objects that are represented in continuous space? Obviously this is continuous space, numeric attributes हैं, m dimensional continuous space. So I think all of you are familiar with the Euclidean Euclidean distance, right? So you can use the Euclidean distance, which is basically the sum of the square distance between the two objects. Or if those two objects are plotted with scale in m dimensional space, this would be the straight line distance. Okay. So Euclidean distance is the straight line distance. So So what would the formula for Euclidean distance? Let me quickly write it. Euclidean distance between the two objects, square root of these are now vectors. I'm not bolding them, but you should understand that these are vectors. Okay. So actually vectors are usually column vectors. ठीक है ना. तो जब भी हम vectors की बात करते हैं, unless although above मैंने उसको row में लिखा था, but जब vectors की बात करते हैं usually we assume they are columns. ठीक है. तो इसलिए फिर मैं यहाँ मैं transpose डाल रहा हूँ. ठीक है. Then xi minus xj. So this is the Euclidean distance between these two objects. ठीक है. उसको आप summation में भी लिख सकते हैं. Summation में लिखेंगे तो sum over all the attribute values करनी पड़ेगी आपको. ठीक है. Of course, since you have inner product square हो रहा है आपके पास. Each value inner. By the way, this vector multiplication is an inner product. So एक scalar value आएगी, scalar का under root मिलेगा, तो distance is always scalar. ठीक है. And as I said, geometrically, this is a straight line distance between these two points in m-dimensional space. ठीक है. तो very quickly, I know you have already known this, but another other measures are Manhattan distance. So Manhattan distance doesn't square it. The Manhattan distance is simply absolute. ठीक है. Yeah, I think that's fine. But absolute, मैंने हर एक के साथ लगाना पड़ेगा इसको. फिर मैं दूसरी तरीके से लिख लूँ summation form में. So basically, you have basically sum of let's say k is equal to 1^(m). ठीक है. m are the number of features. So absolute x I k minus x j k. ठीक है. So basically the sum of the differences without any sign between the two values of the two objects. ठीक है. So this is the Manhattan distance. If you write the previous case में ये square होगा, एब्सोल्यूट नहीं होगा, सिर्फ स्क्वायर होगा, जो ऊपर वाला Euclidean distance था. एंड इन जनरल यू हैव व्हाट इज नोन एज द मिनकोवस्की डिस्टेंस. मिनकोवस्की डिस्टेंस में ऑफ कोर्स आपके पास यू raise it to some power. So again, you have a sum, j is k is equal to 1 to m. Okay. Then you have x I k minus x j k raised to power of some p. And then, of course, 1 over p. Okay. So this is the formula for in general. Of course, this is general formulation. P 1 hoga ta ye Manhattan ban jayega. P aapke paas 2 hoga ta Euclidean distance ban jayega and so on. Theek hai? So obviously which measure would you prefer? In practice, mostly Euclidean distance he use hota for numeric attributes. There might be some reasonings for using some other value of p other than 2, but they are very rare. Usually in computer vision ya koi aur applications mein hum Minkowski distance with other values of p use karte hain, but they are not very common. Okay. Manhattan distance wahan use kar sakte hain. For example, as the name suggests, aapke distance is straight line ban nahi sakte. If you want to find a distance between two points and those two points are always connected by straight lines grid pe hai, so you have to go one way and then go the other way, to uspe Manhattan distance use hoga, straight line distance nahi hoga. So is tarah ki reasoning aapne use karni hai to decide which measure to use for numeric attributes. Isme in saro mein se ek aur variation hai, especially for Euclidean, wo hai Mahalanobis. Mahalanobis again distance. Mahalanobis distance is like the Euclidean distance, but it normalizes it is using the covariance matrix. So aap isko is tarah bhi samajh sakte hain, jab aapne apne data set ko covariance matrix ke sath jaise z scores aapne iske nikale hue hain, and then you compute Euclidean distance, you're actually computing Mahalanobis distance. Okay, but let's say if you're not done that pre-processing and you normalize the distance using this covariance matrix, to aap Mahalanobis distance at this point nikal rahe hain. Okay, so this is again more common in computer vision, and it's more common in data sets that is somewhat skewed. So skewed data sets ke liye this is preferred, because covariance se wo skew adjust ho jata hai. But ek direction mein, let's say aapka spread zyada hai, dusre direction mein kam hai, so this would kind of fix it. But a word of caution, because let's say covariance jo variance hi hai different axis mein, wahi aap dhoondna cha rahe the aur aapne isko normalize kar diya, to wo fir aapki clustering mein highlight nahi hoga. So you need to be aware ki aap kya apply kar rahe hain aur kis purpose ke liye apply kar rahe hain. So if those variances are important to you, then you should not normalize using covariance or using z score normalization. Theek hai? So this was continuous attributes. So what about categorical attributes? Theek hai? Categorical attributes only, for example. Theek hai? So isme and of course categorical attributes mein ek badi distinction hai ki binary attributes bhi ho sakte hain, to wo bhi hum dekhenge. For let me start with the generic categorical attributes. So isme similarity ek define typically karte hain hum, so which is called a simple matching coefficient. Theek hai? So basically it's very simple. So number of values that match between xi and xj divided by total number of attributes. Theek hai? So very simple. So let's say aapke paas do hai, ek gender male hai, और दूसरा लेट से कलर की बात हो रही है, रेड है, और लेट से तीसरी कोई चीज ले लेते हैं, लेट से एड्रेस ले लेते हैं, एड्रेस लेट से एक्स है, ठीक है, तो दूसरा फीमेल है, कलर ये भी रेड है और एड्रेस एक्स है, ठीक है, सो ऑब्वियसली टू फीचर्स आर मैचिंग, 2/3 वुड बी द सिमिलैरिटी, ठीक है, तो काउंट द नंबर ऑफ टाइम्स दैट देयर इज अ मैचेस डिवाइड बाय टोटल नंबर ऑफ एट्रीब्यूट्स, ठीक है, दिस इज अ सिमिलैरिटी, ऑफ कोर्स 1 माइनस ये करेंगे तो वो डिसिमिलैरिटी बन जाएगी, ठीक है, सो व्हाट इज बाय द वे इज अ सिंपल डिस्टिंक्शन बिटवीन सिमिलैरिटी एंड डिसिमिलैरिटी, यूजली जो है ना सिमिलैरिटी यूजली ऑल्दो नॉट ऑलवेज इज नॉर्मलाइज्ड, ठीक है, यूजली सिमिलैरिटी मेजर्स आर नॉर्मलाइज्ड, सो यूजली 0 और 1 के दरमियान है, ठीक है, बट डिसिमिलैरिटी मेजर्स यूजली आर 0 एंड लेट्स से इन्फिनिटी, अपर लिमिट कोई नहीं होती, ठीक है, यूजली ऑफ कोर्स यू विल हैव एक्सेप्शंस, फॉर एग्जांपल इसका 1 माइनस सिमिलैरिटी इसका करेंगे तो वो नॉर्मलाइज डिस्टेंस मेजर होगा, ठीक है, सो बट इफ यू लुक एट द मैनहट्टन डिस्टेंस उसका मिनिमम 0 है, मैक्सिमम उसका इन्फिनिटी हो सकता है, सिमिलरली फॉर यूक्लिडियन डिस्टेंस, ठीक है, सो इन जनरल वी वुड लाइक सम डिग्री ऑफ नॉर्मलाइजेशन बट इट्स नॉट लाइक ए स्ट्रॉन्ग रिक्वायरमेंट, तो ठीक है, तो ये सिंपल मैचिंग कोफिशिएंट है, सो व्हाट अबाउट बाइनरी एट्रीब्यूट्स ओनली, बाइनरी एट्रीब्यूट्स एज वी हैव सीन प्रीवियसली एज वेल, जब हम कोअकरेंस डिस्कस कर रहे थे, जब आइटम सेट रूल्स की बात कर रहे थे, तो यू हैव मैनी 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 मोर मेजर्स, तो उसमें आपके पास बहुत सारी ऑप्शंस है, ऑफकोर्स सिंपल मैचिंग कोफिशिएंट भी यूज कर सकते हैं, ठीक है, बट यू ऑल्सो हैव अदर मेजर लाइक फॉर एग्जाम्पल जैकर्ड कोफिशिएंट, ठीक है, यू कैन ऑल्सो यूज द सोरेंसन डाइस एज वी डिस्कस्ड अर्लियर, ठीक है, एंड सो ऑन, तो जैकर्ड कोफिशिएंट एज यू रिमेंबर फ्रॉम एसोसिएशन रूल माइनिंग, उसमें डिनोमिनेटर में वी डू नॉट काउंट, सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल जैकर्ड कोफिशिएंट में बाइनरी कोई बनाता हूँ 1, 0 और 0, ठीक है, एंड लेट से 1, 0, 0 किया तो ये 1, 1 हो गया, और ये 1 है और ये 0 है, ठीक है, सो इफ आई डू द सिंपल मैचिंग कोफिशिएंट, सिंपल मैचिंग कोफिशिएंट क्या होगा इसका, 1/3 होगा, राइट, तो जैकर्ड कोफिशिएंट इसका क्या होगा, सो हाउ मेनी मैचेस डू यू हैव, सॉरी 2 ऊपर वाला 2 नहीं होगा, एक सेकेंड, हाँ 2 होगा, सो 2/3, ठीक है, सो जैकर्ड कोफिशिएंट में ऊपर 2 ही होगा, मैच हो रहा है, बट डिनोमिनेटर में वी डू नॉट काउंट, रिमेंबर ए प्लस बी प्लस सी होता था, डी इंक्लूड नहीं होता था, डी क्या था, जो 0-0 के मैचेस हो रहे थे, ठीक है, सो वी डू नॉट काउंट दैट, सो दिस वुड बी 2/2 = 1, ठीक है, सो अगेन ये क्यों हम करना चाहेंगे, ये टिपिकली वहां हम करना चाहेंगे, वहां बाइनरी उन बाइनरी एट्रीब्यूट डिस्क्राइब डेटा सेट्स के लिए करना चाहेंगे जहां जो एक एट्रीब्यूट वैल्यू इज मोर इम्पोर्टेंट देन द अदर, इसमें फॉर एग्जाम्पल इन दिस एग्जाम्पल दैट आई गेव 0 को मैंने लेस इम्पोर्टेंस दी है, उसको मैंने डिनोमिनेटर के अकाउंट में नहीं डाला, ठीक है, तो सो दोज टाइप्स ऑफ एट्रीब्यूट्स आर कॉल्ड एसिमेट्रिक, ठीक है, एंड उसमें एग्जाम्पल जो टिपिकल एग्जाम्पल्स आती हैं वो फॉर एग्जाम्पल मेडिसिन में आती हैं, फॉर एग्जाम्पल आपने कोई टेस्ट किया है और मल्टीपल टेस्ट किए हैं और उनकी वैल्यूज हैं. फॉर एग्जांपल पहले टेस्ट पॉजिटिव निकला, दूसरा टेस्ट पॉजिटिव निकला, जीरो नेगेटिव जीरो नेगेटिव. ठीक है, ए मैच ऑन द नेगेटिव्स इज लेस इम्पॉर्टेंट इन दिस सिनेरियो एज कम्पेयर टू ए मैच ऑन द पॉजिटिव्स. तो उसको हाईलाइट करने के लिए वी प्रॉबली यूज जैकेट कोफिशिएंट रादर देन सिंपल मैचिंग कोफिशिएंट. और इन अदर वर्ड यू कैन से दैट दिस प्रॉब्लम की जो डेटा जो रिप्रेजेंटेशन है, इट इज रिप्रेजेंटेड बाय एसिमेट्रिक बाइनरी एट्रीब्यूट्स. वन बाइनरी एट्रीब्यूट इज कंसिडर मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट देन द अदर. All right, so let's move on. So this was all binary attributes. And we also previously discussed categorical attributes. Remember categorical or discrete attributes mein, for categorical attributes or discrete attributes, you can have distinction between ordinal and nominal. Upar jo humne discuss kiya abhi all nominal the. So what about if you have ordinal? And again, we are still talking about all ordinal attributes. So let's say rankings hain, grades hain, all of these are ordinal attributes. So let's say mere paas rankings hain for different things. Pehle ka 3 hai, dusre ka 1 hai, teesre ka 7 hai, and so on. Aur dusre ka let's say 2 hai, 3 hai, aur 1 hai. So how do you find the similarity between the two? Again, ye maine ordinal likha hua hai, but aur unko maine number se encode kar diya. So usually sometimes numbers nahi honge to aapko khud hi pehle number mein code change karna padega. For example, grades ki main baat karta hu. So you know, for example, ke A is better than B and B is better than C. To aap encoding pehle kar dein, A ko 1 de dein, B ko 2 de dein, C ko 3 de dein, and so on. Theek hai. So after you have done this, you can actually apply the measures for numeric attributes. Theek hai? So you can actually apply those. Theek hai? So distance aapke paas aa jayega, and but yeah, okay. You can apply that as well, but the other approach is that you do it attribute by attribute, so that you normalize each. For example, aapka pehla attribute jo maine aap upar kya value likhi thi, let's say uski 7 possible values hain. Theek hai, to 7 possible values hain, to aap usko fir normalize kar sakte hain difference ko. Let's say a ka 3 tha, dusra ka 1 tha. So divided by 7. So this would give you a normalized value between the two. Or phir sari normalized value ko sum kar liya, attribute by attribute. Theek hai? So I think yahi tha isme. So basically ordinal attributes mein you basically convert the attributes to ranks. If they are, let's say, letters or something else, you convert them to ranks from 1 to whatever maximum possible values. Then you use attribute wise normalized values and then sum them up. Okay. Okay, finally, let's say if you have mixed attribute types. Okay. So far previously we talked about different attribute types, but the objects were described with all the objects were described with attributes of the same type. They were either all categorical, they were either all nominal, they were all ordinal, all binary, all numeric. Whatever, what happens if they are mixed, and which is more common in practice? Theek hai? So mixed mein, again we resort to attribute by attribute aggregation. So let's say pehla mere paas let's say age hai, let's say dusra let's say weight hai, both of these are continuous. Phir let's say mere paas koi grade aa gaya which is nominal, और फिर लेट्स से इसके बाद कलर आ गया विच इज सॉरी एज ग्रेड इज ऑर्डिनल एंड कलर इज नॉमिनल बोथ कैटेगोरिकल ठीक है तो इस तरह की चीज है तो देन यू प्रोसीड एट्रीब्यूट बाय एट्रीब्यूट सो आप एज का पहले लेट्स से दो मैं ले लेता हूँ लेट्स से ये 25 एज था वेट उसका 72 था और दूसरी चीज उसकी ग्रेड लेट्स से ए था और देन वी हैड और क्या था कलर लेट्स से रेड था एंड लेट्स से मेरे पास एक 32 है 68 है और ये क्या था सो बी एंड लेट्स से आर ठीक है सो नाउ यू प्रोसीड एट्रीब्यूट बाय एट्रीब्यूट सो इफ यू टॉक अबाउट एज एज बेसिकली वुड देन बी 32 माइनस 25 डिवाइडेड बाय मैक्स एज माइनस मेन एज इन द डेटा सेट ठीक है ऑफकोर्स ये मैं दो ऑब्जेक्ट्स लिए हैं बाकी डेटा सेट की इंफॉर्मेशन होनी चाहिए कि उसमें मेन क्या था मैक्स क्या था सो दैट यू कैन नॉर्मलाइज दिस बिटवीन 0 एंड 1 ये हो गया फिर उसके बाद अब आता है मेरे पास दूसरा क्या था वेट था वो भी कंटिन्यूस है तो वो भी उसी तरह ही होगा वेट सो वट एवर द टू वेट्स आर 72 माइनस लेट्स से 68 लिखा था आई डोंट रिमेंबर अगेन डिवाइडेड बाय मैक्स वेट माइनस मेन वेट ठीक है ये दूसरा हो गया तीसरा था रैंक्स था तो रैंक्स में ऑफकोर्स अब लेट्स से ए का रैंक 1 है बी का रैंक 2 है तो दिस वुड बी 2 माइनस 1 डिवाइडेड बाय वट एवर द टोटल नंबर ऑफ रैंक्स यू हैव लेट्स से मुझे नहीं पता 7 होते हैं कितने होते हैं तो ये हो जाएगा रैंक्स के लिए एंड देन फॉर द नॉमिनल इट्स सिंपली सिंपल मैचिंग कोफिशिएंट सो इफ इट मैचेस यू गेट ए 1 इफ इट डजंट मैचेस यू गेट ए 0 इन दिस पर्टिकुलर केस इट्स 1 एंड देन यू एड ऑल ऑफ दीज टुगेदर and normalized by the number of attributes. Because remember, each of these values are now between 0 and 1. If you add 4 values and divide by 4, you still get a value between 0 and 1. Okay? So this was for mixed attribute types. So mere khayal se that is pretty much what I wanted to cover for today. And we're also running out of time. By the way, this part, similarity measures, is in, I think, chapter 3. It's not in chapter 9. It is in chapter 3. Jo pre-processing ka chapter tha na, usme ye diya hua hai. So if you want to revise this, you should go back to chapter 3. Aur chapter 3 ki slides mein hi hai zyada details. Uski slides bhi dekh sakte hain. So any questions? So any questions? So I think we will not have a quiz on Monday. तो आपको एक या दो हफ्ते एक हफ्ते की ब्रेक मिल जाएगी एक हफ्ते की या दो हफ्ते के एग्जाम्स के बाद भी देखते हैं लेट्स से 2 वीक्स की ब्रेक मिल जाएगी वी स्टिल बी एबल टू प्रॉब्ली डू 9 आई थिंक सही है सो बट आई डोंट नो इफ यू गाइस आर ओके वी कैन डू ए क्विज ऑन मंडे Any has any feedback, although a participant बहुत थोड़े हैं क्लास में any ideas, no feedback? अच्छा so I got one feedback, वो कह रहा है कि quiz होना चाहिए अच्छा so now it's 2 So now I still, okay, 3-2, 3 yes, 2 no's, right? एक्चुअली लोग बहुत थोड़े अच्छा सो अच्छा चलें ठीक है सो दैट्स फाइन बिकॉज आई गेस आप लोगों के और भी एग्जाम शुरू होने वाले होंगे तो यू माइट नॉट बी पेइंग टू मच अटेंशन टू व्हाट इज गोइंग ऑन तो ठीक है सो यू कैन बिकॉज फॉर एग्जांपल एनएलपी का क्विज दिस सैटरडे है तो फॉर दोज हु आर टेकिंग बोथ कोर्सेज सो दे विल बी बिजी इन द एनएलपी क्विज एनएलपी एग्जाम सॉरी एंड देन ऑफकोर्स वी हैव द डीएम एग्जाम द फॉलोइंग सैटरडे ठीक है